I just fell in love with her.
She loved to run on the beach. She truly was my angel here on Earth.
She had a sense of humor.
She was the love of my life.
I think I'm doing everything right for him, yet he develops cancer.
My seemingly happy, healthy dog was going to die within 6 to 18 months.
This was the one thing I couldn't protect her from.
I felt helpless.
How do you make the best decisions for this pal who can't talk to you?
There's a lot of fear involved.
It was just this real sense of despair and hopelessness.
I think the most difficult part about dealing with cancer is just the unknown.
I never really gave a second thought about lymphoma in dogs.
I wish I had had that lump checked earlier.
I don't want to lose my dog. I can't lose my dog.
Lymphoma is one of the most treatable cancers, in my opinion.
We do see a very high percentage of dogs respond to chemotherapy.
We can always improve their quality of life.
There is a solution and option for everyone. Lymphoma, like all types of cancer, is a mystery to most people. They don't even know that dogs get cancer. And when lymphoma strikes their pet, they're absolutely dumbfounded.
We all want to do everything we can to protect our pets from harm. When canine lymphoma attacks, we can fight back. But first, we need to arm ourselves with as much knowledge as possible.
Cancer is the number one natural cause of death in dogs and in cats in the industrialized world. It's also the most preventable of all chronic diseases and the most curable of all chronic diseases. The greatest thing that could be done to save the lives of unbelievable numbers of dogs with lymphoma is just to bring about awareness. Lymphoma is where a cell of the immune system called a lymphocyte becomes a cancer cell. Most people find lumps, usually right here, below the jaw. But when you actually talk to the families, they say, you know, for the last several weeks, my dog has just been lethargic and has not been feeling well, and that these are actually earlier signs of lymphoma, just kind of like the batteries are wearing out. The good news is that it's very rapidly responsive, and quality of life improves very quickly with therapy.
If your dog is diagnosed with lymphoma, your veterinary team will know the best weapons to pull from their arsenal to fight the disease.
Every type of lymphoma is treated uniquely. Sometimes it involves radiation. Often it involves chemotherapy.
I always recommend integrating holistic therapies with cancer treatment, including lymphoma. Integrative medicine is traditional veterinary medicine that includes therapies such as acupuncture, chiropractic supplements from a Western standpoint, Chinese medicines.
There is always an option that can be used to benefit and enhance their pet's quality of life.
There are preventative measures every dog owner can take to help protect their dog from lymphoma.
Maintaining a nice body structure without obesity or even plumpness throughout life is clearly been shown both in dogs and in people to enhance quality of life, reduce the prevalence of cancer.
Good nutrition is important for their overall health because it gives them the terrain in their body to keep cancer away. The benefits of feeding pets a whole food diet is that you're giving them antioxidants and other phytonutrients and healthy essentials versus giving them something that's completely processed.
Sometimes we can do everything right for our dogs, but lymphoma still waits in the shadows, ready to strike. Even veterinary professionals can't always keep their dogs safe from lymphoma. When holistic veterinarian Dr. Patrick Mahaney decided to get a dog, he knew he wanted a companion who was smart, athletic, and cute. he found the perfect match in a fluffy little Welsh terrier. Cardiff led an idyllic life with his two dads, Patrick and husband Phil, until lymphoma reared its ugly head.
Having my own dog get diagnosed with cancer has made me a lot more empathetic towards my clients whose dogs are also undergoing cancer treatment. I don't know if we have the time for me to fully describe all the aspects of Cardiff that makes him who he is at this point in his life. He is a almost 9-year-old Welsh Terrier who I've had since he was a puppy. He's just the most perfect dog ever.
Despite Patrick's expert care and constant attention, Cardiff's health took a turn for the worse.
The first time we detected that something might not be right with him, he started not really wanting to have his food, and that kind of led us into the exploratory ultrasound to find out what is really in there causing the issue.
Veterinarians who have pets are very used to practicing on our own animals, but I also feel like I'm not the highest level of expertise in certain things, nor am I board certified as a veterinary oncologist. So I have to rely on those who have more experience and expertise than myself to help me and therefore help him in the process.
When we imaged Cardiff, we found that there was a mass in the intestines, and so therefore we decided to go forward with surgery.
As a doctor, Patrick knew there was a possibility Cardiff could have lymphoma, but as a concerned dad, he held out hope for the best.
I was hopeful, actually, in removing the mass, that it might not even be cancer. There it was, he had T-cell lymphoma. I'm kind of conflicted internally because I think I'm doing everything right for him, yet he develops cancer.
It was pretty rough news for me to hear. You know, the first thing you think of is, my pet's gonna die because he has cancer. And then you start peeling back and realizing, is it treatable, is it not treatable?
As soon as a dog is diagnosed with lymphoma, doctors focus their efforts on achieving remission.
The goal of therapy is to eliminate all clinical evidence of disease. So remission can mean cure, or it can mean lack of any evidence of disease.
With the potential for this type of cancer to be all over the body, I wanted to really give him the best chance to have a normal quality of life for many years to come. Therefore, I elected to put him through the treatment process with chemotherapy.
Because every case is different, chemotherapy treatments can vary from dog to dog. However, the CHOP protocol is the standard.
The CHOP protocol is the most common for the treatment of lymphoma in people and in animals. CHOP stands for the drugs that are used to treat lymphoma, which includes cyclophosphamide, vincristine, prednisone, doxorubicin, and in many cases, L-asparaginase. Chemotherapy affects the cancer's survival mechanisms. It specifically targets the cell's ability to divide and grow and flourish.
It's natural for dog owners to resist the idea of giving their pet chemotherapy. Most of us know someone who has suffered debilitating side effects from their cancer treatment. But in reality, dogs handle chemotherapy much better than humans.
The focus of chemotherapy in dogs is really based more on quality of life than finding a cure. We treat them with lower doses of chemotherapy. They tolerate the treatment much better. And statistically, about 75 to 80% of dogs that get chemotherapy will not have any significant side effects.
Patrick's expertise as a holistic veterinarian proved invaluable in providing Cardiff an integrative program to accompany his chemotherapy.
We do have to recognize that we're using chemotherapy to kill cancer cells, but it also is killing normal cells. Therefore, we can take that integrative approach and try to focus on supporting those body systems so that fewer side effects are seen. So it's a very natural decision for me to apply that to my own dog.
Cardiff is handling his treatment really well so far. He's reported to have a little bit of decreased appetite after his treatments, but he's been very readily hand-fed and loves all the extra attention that he's getting.
Patrick and Phil know the importance of keeping Cardiff free from stress, so they do their best to make treatment days as consistent as possible.
When Cardiff receives his chemotherapy, he's always happy to go there, he's happy to see everyone, he's not really happy about the treatments, but then it's over and then he's happy again, and you know, we usually do something fun like go to the dog park right afterwards so he can see all his friends, and
We try to make it as fun for him as possible. And if that means canceling vacations or staying up all night or feeding or, you know, going to all this trouble and effort and expense, it's worth it.
Over the last few months, Cardiff has continued on chemotherapy with the assistance of integrative medicine.
I'm able to buy him almost a whole nother half of his life by putting him through this process. And I'm also recognizing that the side effects that he's experiencing are extremely minor.
In late July, Cardiff's dad and his many friends threw a 9th birthday party and end up chemo bash to celebrate his triumph over lymphoma.
I'm happy, Cardiff's happy, Patrick's happy. I'm just really happy that everything seems to be behind us from a cancer standpoint, and that Cardiff is 9 years old.
Pets with cancer really defy their disease on a daily basis and inspire me constantly. They're not defined by that disease. We are oftentimes, and we are the ones that suffer with it.
Like his legendary namesake, Paul Newman is an irresistibly handsome heartbreaker with stunning blue eyes. This rare white basset hound is also a star in his own right, appearing regularly in film, television, and theater. But Paul was living in the most humble of surroundings when he was discovered by trainer Karen Wells and her husband, Andy Wilder.
Oh, Lord, Paul Newman. So they found him in an abandoned garage in Jersey City. Young puppy, you know, maybe 6 months, like starving, really skinny. I took one look at this dog. It was like looking at a unicorn, and it just sort of took my breath away. And I feel that way about him almost every day when I see him. I just go, my God, you're so wonderful.
Sometimes you're blessed enough to have what I call the once-in-a-lifetime dog, and there's just this dog that crawls into your heart, knows you just as well as you know them, and Paul Newman, to me, is her once-in-a-lifetime dog.
The bond she has with Paul Newman is amazing. It's very deep and, you know, very interdependent.
He trained really, really well right from the start. I mean, I was amazed. So I thought, well, maybe we could make money for rescue if I trained this dog and got him into, you know, commercials, TV, that kind of thing.
While Paul Newman and Karen were making a name for themselves in show business, subtle signs of lymphoma were beginning to surface.
A great thing to do is to pet your dog, know your dog's lumps and bumps, know what's normal, what's not normal. More than 50% of dogs with lymphoma will feel well at the time of diagnosis.
He had lumps on his throat, and I'm like, well, where'd this come from? You know, maybe he's got a little cold. But they got bigger and they never got smaller. You know, we took him in, they aspirated, we waited 2 days, she called and with the test results and said he had lymphoma. And I thought, my God, I don't want to lose my dog. I can't lose my dog.
I don't want to think of the ultimate outcome of what often happens with lymphoma, but I was trying to think, okay, what can we do to extend his life and keep his life as the best quality possible?
Without treatment, the average dog with lymphoma will only live a month, 30 days. But with standard chemotherapy, we can extend that to over a year.
And I cried, and then I said, I'm going to get the best freaking team together and save this dog. I'm going to do everything I possibly can.
Finding the right team begins with your veterinarian and often a veterinary oncologist. Believing in them and working together with your dog's quality of life as your goal can make all the difference in the world.
Make sure they're really, really good at what they do and coordinate with them in everything you do.
So probably what we should do with Paul Newman is take him in, get his temp and weight, run his blood work just to CBC, and then pop him back in the room, and then I'll come talk to them about the different options because he has one stubborn lymph node that doesn't want to go into remission.
It's kind of nonstop right now between work and then taking Paul Newman to his chemo and wherever else he needs to go. A lot of people can't afford treatment. We're lucky enough that we have a little bit in savings that we can spend on this, and that's what we're doing.
Traditionally, we don't think about cutting out lymphoma. We've talked about that.
Right.
It's not a cancer that you cut out. What I would propose is potentially removing that lymph node because the rest of the lymph nodes are in remission.
Right.
Before I would do that,
right.
I would do chest x-rays and ultrasound.
Yep.
Because if his liver is full of lymphoma or his spleen, removing the lymph node doesn't make sense. If the rest of his body is, quote unquote, in remission, then I think it makes sense to get rid of this resistant clone of cells. All right, I'll be back in a few.
All right, thank you.
You okay with that?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll be back in a few.
What do you think?
About?
What we should do.
I think we should do what we're doing. We're going to get an ultrasound, and we're going to aspirate the liver and the spleen, and then we're going to get the results of that in a day. We'll see the ultrasound right away. Oh. But if it says that there's no cancer anywhere else.
Right, then you think we should.
I think we should get it out. I do.
I don't think he would have such a good chance if I didn't have Andy helping me with this. Andy has to listen to hours of me talking about, let's try this, he did that, what should we do here, you know, me breaking down. It's a real gift to have somebody in your life that is going to be that supportive.
The alternative plan would be to say, we either keep him on the current protocol, accepting partial remission,
right.
But then I think he's going to relapse sooner because of that, or we switch to a quote-unquote rescue protocol.
Right.
To me, the problem with the rescue protocol is I'd like to save him for later because the rest of him is responding.
Cancer cells mutate constantly. So when they're treated with one drug, they then very quickly then try to mutate to become resistant to that drug. But yet another drug can be quite effective. If we're giving the treatment and the disease starts to recur, then using those same medicines doesn't make sense. We need to choose other drugs that are called rescue protocols that will be able to re-induce a remission.
I think we're making the right decision for him. I really, really do.
After a very long and emotional day, Paul Newman has one last stop to make with Dr. Joseph for acupuncture.
With acupuncture, it's a whole different philosophy than with conventional medicine. And we're talking about energy, we're talking about chi. And if you throw the words yin and yang in it, it really sounds hokey pokey. But it's really the biochemical manipulation of energy in the body. The strange thing about it, which supports the basis of Chinese medicine, when it works, it lasts.
Dogs feel our emotions, but they don't have the ability to understand the implications of lymphoma. They're just happy to be with us. So it is our job as guardians to shelter them from our negative feelings and just let them be happy.
Cancer and chemotherapy and radiation and surgery, those words have become enveloped in blackness and evil, and it's feared, and they suck out all hope. We know those things, but our dogs don't. So they don't think in many ways that we do. But if we're affected, if we're worried, if we're concerned, if we're fearful, then they feed off that. They understand that something is wrong. So it's not the chemotherapy or the lymphoma. It is actually really our fear that they're feeding off of.
We do a prayer circle for him. On Sundays at 12 o'clock.
Hey guys.
Hello.
Hello, yo.
How are you?
I'm good.
Hi,
how are you, baby?
It's tremendous to have a wonderful community that supports Paul Newman and everything that we're doing with him.
Well, we've come together as a community to be with each other and to be with Paul Newman. This is a wonderful community. Paul's a part of it, but we've come to lift ourselves up as a community, but also to invoke the participation in the larger community of faith in the universe that Paul is such a wonderful part of. Give him strength, give him courage, heal him. We know that he's loved by many, especially by you. Let that love strengthen him and give him life. I invite you all to join in with your prayers for Paul Newman.
Please take this cancer out of his body, God, and let it never come back, please, please.
When the prayer circle came to a close, Karen and Andy received the call they had been anxiously waiting for.
Hi, it's Dr. Edinger from Animal Specialty Center with good news for Paul Newman. Both of his liver and spleen came back normal, so no evidence of lymphoma there, which is great news. So I would go ahead and have the lymph node removed.
Once Paul Newman recovered from surgery, he and Karen were back on the set doing what they love. Despite Karen and Andy's efforts, Paul Newman never achieved complete remission. They continued with holistic medicine and explored other methods of treatment, including entering Paul Newman in a clinical trial.
Everybody wants a cure for cancer, and that's what the researchers are working on. But I think for the average dog, it would help the owners if we thought about cancer as a chronic condition, like heart disease or kidney disease. We may not be able to cure the disease, but we can treat it, and the pet will live with that disease, and they can live longer and feel better than they will without treatment for it.
It's going to affect both of us tremendously if Paul Newman loses this battle with lymphoma. All I know is that we've learned so much being with Paul Newman that we'll be able to use that the rest of our lives.
A part of me will die with him, and I know my life will never be the same. I'm not sure how I'm gonna get up and go on. So I can't lose this dog. I just can't.
When lymphoma is diagnosed, it's a devastating feeling. I hate giving that diagnosis because I know what the people are going through, and I know how deeply it touches every member of that family. And I know from that point on, nothing will be quite right. I know that even 5 or 10 years later, people remember that moment.
I don't ever think that there is a definitive time frame saying, you know what, you're going to start grieving today and in 6 months it'll be gone. It's a constant emotion that I think, you know, lives within us when we've lost something precious. It's been almost 3 years and I can be outside and see a chocolate lab and burst into tears.
Whether we are trying to process the diagnosis, fighting the dreaded disease, or dealing with the passing of our pet, an undeniable loss is suffered. Our lives are turned upside down. Our control is stolen. And we feel completely helpless.
There's a phrase that I love. The grieving heart has a huge capacity to be understood, but very little capacity to understand. So when you're sitting there talking to your vet and they're shooting all these things back and forth, you know, medical terms and treatment options and all of that, it may be good to have someone there by your side and help you through that journey. Grief typically will begin, although it may not be recognized at the moment of a terminal diagnosis or realization that death may be coming. I don't think one ever gets over grief. You just learn to cope with the new normal.
When Vivian Villanueva lost her beloved Lily, she decided to honor her dog's life by helping others cope with loss.
When I found out that Lily was diagnosed with lymphoma, I was devastated. It's as if a train had hit me. It was so unexpected. From one day to the next, I'm being told that my seemingly happy, healthy dog was going to die within 6 to 18 months. Both my husband are pet professionals in the veterinary world. Death and dying are something that we deal with every day. But when we went through it ourselves, we found that there wasn't a whole lot of support. And if we didn't know where to turn to, where would Mr. and Mrs. Smith know where to turn to? So that's how Lily's journey brought us here. I would suggest to pet parents that know that their pet has limited time to really focus on the present. Really take each moment, each day, and be thankful that you have that time.
At some point, we may be called upon to make a painful choice. But how do we know when to let go? What defines quality of life? It means many things to many people, and it is extremely personal.
It's hard to know when the right time is, and if we're not sure, we wait. And I can tell you from being a pet owner with my sick dog, that it's really hard to know when the right time is. And sometimes, you need the people around you to help you make that decision, because it's really hard to be objective.
Think of the three things that your pet loves to do, whether it's fetching a ball, going for a run on the beach, you know, eating their favorite food. And if you get to that point that they're not enjoying their life and they're suffering and they're painful, then euthanasia is a gift.
We hear things from our dogs all the time. We understand how they feel, we understand how their expressions affect us, and hearing that it's time to say goodbye is a clear message.
Whatever decision you make, whatever journey, path you're taking, is to maintain the quality of life.
Losing a canine family member could be one of the most difficult things we have to face in life. You are allowed to mourn.
I believe that there's a lot of shame for pet parents to grieve for their pet because it's not as accepted as you would a human family member. It's always a normal process. Grief is a natural, normal emotion that we have when we lose something that we love or precious to us.
For every tear shed, there is a smile. We cannot understand how or why life unfolds as it does, but we can be sure that we should never give up hope.
Every day, we see things that are beyond our understanding of why things go so well. We see things that are beyond medicine.
When the time came for the Vanderwerk family to get a dog, they had a challenge on their hands. Caroline's mom wanted a companion, but Caroline wanted a dog to compete in agility. After careful research, they found the perfect breeder with the perfect dog. Bree was the best of both worlds, a sweet, cuddly little dog at home and a rocket on the agility course. She also turned out to be something of a miracle.
Don't ever let somebody tell you that a dog at that age cannot get cancer. A dog at that age, any dog can get it, just like humans, just like kids. She can turn it on in the ring and turn it off the minute you walk out and literally be on your lap, falling asleep. And that's the way she was as a puppy. She was my heart dog. She really is.
Running Bree on a course is nothing short of amazing. And I never really thought how much of a unique or amazing experience it was until I ran her up in Portland and put a excellent title on her. I realized that she shouldn't even have learned to play the game, to run agility.
Bree's story is so interesting because when Caroline and her family came to get a puppy, they said, you know, we just really don't want cancer. And I thought, well, you know, we don't have a lot of cancer in our breed, so, you know, that should probably be okay.
She was an easy dog to train. She literally spoiled me for training. I've never owned a dog like her. I mean, 1, 2, 3, got it, let's move on. 1, 2, 3, got it, let's move on. Just a sweetheart. I just fell in love with her.
Little did she know that she and her new companion would soon be helping each other through the fight of their lives. Shortly after she got Bree, Caroline went to the hospital for neck surgery.
The surgery I went through was very hard on me. And I was in the hospital for 14 days. They let her come in the hospital to come in and visit with me. She was just a great support. And when I got out and having to learn how to walk and write and everything and all the pain of recouping, she was by my side the whole time.
When Caroline was finally up to it, they slowly began doing agility again.
I was training her, and it was a windy day, like Santa Ana's we have. Like humans, I never thought anything about it. She was back sneezing and coughing a little. Let me just run over to the emergency and have her checked.
Bree was about 18 months old, and when she took her into the emergency room, they took chest x-rays, which is what you would normally do when a dog comes in with labored breathing. And her chest had fluid in it. They looked and her abdomen had fluid in it and they could see enlarged lymph nodes. And so when they did a needle aspirate of those lymph nodes, they discovered that she had lymphoma.
I'm looking at all this white in her chest and I'm like, it doesn't look good to me. And you know, I've seen a lot of x-rays just on my own stuff to know that this didn't look right.
Caroline called me and said that Bree had lymphoma and I felt horrible. You would always feel horrible to know that a puppy person had that diagnosis, but in this case, where that was the only thing they didn't want was cancer, I just couldn't believe it. And I talked to our oncologist here, and they said, you know, this isn't good. Bree had the multi-body cavity lymphoma. Lymphoma that's in both the chest and the abdomen is a very bad form of the disease.
I didn't think it was fair. I could understand it in a dog that was 12, 13, even 10, but to a dog that's 18 months old, they haven't even lived life yet.
Caroline made the decision to put her on one of the lymphoma protocols, which is a fairly aggressive chemotherapy regime.
They really did not think she was gonna survive the night. So we took her home after we started her on chemo and they gave her Pred. and some other stuff. And within 3 days, she started feeling better and she was starting to get more energy. And from that point on, we just kept doing chemo. And sometimes she would handle it well, sometimes she wouldn't. She lost all her hair. I mean, literally, whiskers, her beautiful tail that she has.
Dogs are pretty amazing. They don't complain about it. And they just, you know, go on and live their lives.
I was amazed. She still wanted to go play. She still wanted to go get the ball and wanted to run. And she actually was able to start training for agility again during her treatment. No matter what, Bree will enjoy life. I will not stop her from doing what she loves, no matter what. It's not the end of a dog's life. They can continue on, and Bree is an example of that. If they respond to chemo or radiation or whatever treatment you decide to do with your dog, and they want to move on, and you give them the love and they give the love back, there's no stopping them.
In the weeks to come, Bree continued to defy the odds and astound her doctors.
After 3 or 4 weeks into chemo, and they re-ultrasound her, and she was completely into remission by then. And they were amazed. They said they've never seen that happen, that she completely went into remission that quickly. No signs of tumors or anything, they had shrunk down.
In vet school, we were taught that dogs that have the type of lymphoma that she has and multiple body cavities at a young age don't survive. So she is a little miracle.
My goal was to get her to 7, and she's gonna be 8 in July. And all I wanted to do was just get her to 7. I don't think Bree wanted to go anywhere. I really don't think she was ready. She wasn't ready to give up, she was fighting. And she fought hard, and she fought back.
You know, the statistics say that there's a 5% chance. I think people make their own decisions about what's best for them and what they want to take a chance on. I think what's so exciting about Bree is that Caroline was willing to take a chance on her, and it was absolutely worth every penny.
I think Bree got the right home. And I think it goes both ways. We're both very lucky to have each other.
Bree may be considered a miracle dog now, but her success in beating lymphoma could be far less unusual in the future.
Cancer research and lymphoma research is exploding with new discoveries literally every day. Just a few years ago, we didn't even know that there are literally dozens and dozens of different kinds of lymphoma. By understanding specifically the type of lymphoma, then we can be able to then steer the appropriate therapies to defeat that particular type of lymphoma. So diagnostics is a whole explosion of new information. It's an amazing, brave new world.
I think that within the different cancers, we're gonna learn more and more from a molecular level. And I think targeted therapies have certainly been kind of taking cancer research by storm.
The research being done for dogs is also crossing over to humans and vice versa in the forms of translational and comparative oncology. So dogs and their owners are truly in the fight to cure cancer and lymphoma together.
The type of lymphoma that dogs get is identical to a very difficult type of lymphoma in people. Every advance that we make in the diagnosis and treatment of lymphoma in dogs is a great gift to animals and people.
There was actually a study looking at a new compound, hopefully for human lymphoma, went through dogs and was shown to be very effective. But when it got to human clinical trials, it was too toxic. That drug has actually now been bought out by a company that wants to develop it for use in the dog because we have all of that data already.
Dogs battling the disease now will certainly help pave the way for future generations and hopefully reap some of the benefits of cancer research by becoming part of a clinical trial.
If I can have owners know anything about the field of cancer research in dogs, is that we're not treating their patients as large guinea pigs.
We have to find people who are brave. We have to find people who want to give a gift to animals and people of the future by saying, I want to enter my dog into a clinical trial that is a regimented, stepwise evaluation of the safety and effectiveness of bold, new, exciting treatments. And it's an amazing gift to us all, it really is.
These promising advancements against lymphoma would not be possible without the passion of dedicated doctors and researchers who have devoted their lives to beating this disease.
I hate cancer. I hate cancer. I hate cancer. But I love a challenge. This is a medical oncology treatment area where we treat our patients with everything from novel new therapeutics, chemotherapeutic agents. We do other diagnostics in this particular area. I cannot think of a battle more worthy of spending a lifetime with than cancer. One of the neat parts about working here is that we develop new approaches, new treatments that are not seen anywhere else in the world. This is a new therapy that mimics the immune system and is an antibody that's being used to treat lymphoma. So this is the patient that's being treated with that. So it's neat to be a part of the future of veterinary medicine, and we hope of human medicine as well. If I can benefit the life of one animal, and that touches the heart and life of a single person, then I feel that I will have made a tremendous gift, a tremendous accomplishment for society. If I can do that for hundreds or thousands, or if I can make a discovery that will touch the lives of animals and people for a generation, that's a great gift, and that's my hope.
Lymphoma is an enemy that does not play fair, but we can do our best to stay one step ahead of the disease.
Early detection and diagnosis of cancer is the single most important thing that can be incorporated or embraced to be able to enhance and improve cure rates and quality of life.
Wellness exams are so important because we as veterinarians know what to look for. We know how to feel lymph nodes. We know how to feel for lumps and bumps. So we can help you find things. And the earlier you find things, the more successful we are at treating them.
Pet insurance is a lovely gift to animals. Removing the financial crisis really alleviates the burden on the heart, burden on the wallet, and also enables pets that would be denied therapy to have the very best of care.
If your dog is diagnosed with lymphoma or is currently battling the disease, it's normal for you to feel helpless. But it's also important to remember that lymphoma is not a death sentence. You can help your dog.
First thing you need to do is take care of yourself, because this is an emotional roller coaster.
You want to see a specialist within a day or two of having the diagnosis. Go, meet them, get the information, but be prepared to make a decision quickly.
Understand that it is very treatable and that advances are exciting and they're just around the corner.
We see 80 to 90% of dogs that will go into remission with chemotherapy and their quality of life is really good.
Dogs that have a very keen sense of their owner's emotions. And I think that's one of the important reasons to stay optimistic and hopeful during your pet's treatment.
The affordability of treatment does not indicate the level of commitment or love that a person has for their pet. You know, there's still many things that you can give that pet that can't be bought with money. Love, care, compassion, time, but just be at peace that you did what you can for your pet.
The bottom line is, our dogs don't know that they're sick. They aren't worried about tomorrow. They just want the love that we can give them today.
Dogs with lymphoma, specifically with therapy, generally live a wonderful, joyful life. And they teach me and most of my clients and friends every day how we should live life in our own world. Honestly, if we lived our lives like our dogs and cats, this would be a world without war. This would be a world with great joy and a world with a great deal of love.
You can gather strength from those who've walked a mile in your shoes. You aren't alone.
Don't fear cancer, fight it. Let's toast the kids. The two-legged, the four-legged, or three-legged, whatever, but to life.
To the devil. Love her.
Here's to Cody, who's been an incredible dog for our family.
Here's to Dory, Ruthie, Buddy, Mandy, and a few others.
Here's to you, Joey, for all the things you did for me and all the good times we had together.
Raise a toast to Kiri, the best shadow a person could ever have.
Here's to Teddy, to Destiny, my brave warrior,
I love you.
To my sweet baby girl, I raised this glass to toast in your honor.
To Bandit.
To Miss Simba. You're a special little girl.
Let's raise a glass to toast those animals that are currently going through cancer treatment. Let's show our support to the people that are there for them. And just hope everybody does well. Thank you.
You, I will be with you to call you my friend.